దూర విద్యా విధానంలో డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ ఓపెన్ యూనివర్సిటీ దేశంలోనే మొట్టమొదటి సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం. దాదాపు 2.5 దశాబ్దాలుగా దూర విద్యా విధానం ద్వారా కంప్యూటర్ కోర్సును అనుసంధానం చేస్తూ బిఏ బికామ్ బిఎస్సీ డిగ్రీ కోర్సులను అందిస్తోంది. పోస్ట్ గ్రాడ్యుయేషన్ స్థాయి డిగ్రీ డిప్లొమా స్థాయి కోర్సులను ఔత్సాహికులైన విద్యార్థులకు అందిస్తోంది. డెవలప్మెంట్ స్టడీస్లో సెంటర్ ఫర్ ఎకనామిక్స్ అండ్ సోషల్ స్టడీస్ ద్వారా ఎంఫిల్ పిహెచ్డితో పాటు విశ్వవిద్యాలయమే స్వయంగా దూర విద్యా విధాన అంశంపైన పిహెచ్డి వంటి పరిశోధనా కోర్సులు ప్రవేశపెట్టింది. సుమారు 4.5 లక్షల మంది విద్యార్థులు ఈ విశ్వవిద్యాలయం నుంచి ఉన్నత విద్యావకాశాలు పొందుతున్నారు. డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం స్థానికంగా స్వయం బోధనా పద్ధతిలో ముద్రణ రూపంలో రూపొందించిన కోర్స్ మెటీరియల్ అందిస్తోంది. కోర్స్ మెటీరియల్ అధ్యయనానికి సహకరించే విధంగా రేడియో టెలివిజన్ పాఠ్యాంశాల ఆధారంగా కార్యక్రమాలు ప్రసారం చేస్తోంది. అధ్యయన కేంద్రాల ద్వారా ఏర్పాటు చేసే సలహా సంసర్గ తరగతులు సైన్స్ ప్రాక్టికల్ సౌకర్యాలు విద్యార్థులకు స్వయం అధ్యయనానికి ఒక చక్కటి అవకాశం. ఇవి విద్యార్థి సమీపంలో ఉండే అధ్యయన కేంద్రం నుంచే పొందొచ్చు.
Today, we are going to discuss about the certificate program in early childhood care and education being offered by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University since 2011. We have with us two senior teachers, Dr. Vani, retired as principal of Andhra Mahila Sabha College of Teacher Education, Hyderabad, and she was associated with the course development as editor. And to my extreme left is Dr. Mrunalini, serving as professor of education in Usmania University, Hyderabad, and she was also a course writer. Today, in this program, we'll have an overview of the certificate program in early childhood care and education being offered by the university, and also discuss about the early childhood education, its significance. In the first half of the program, we'll be explaining about the program, and then we'll be discussing about the various aspects. And in the second half, the audience can pose questions and seek clarifications. For this, you have to dial the numbers 040-2703-1431, 040-2703-1432, 040-2703-1433. We would be able to take the questions in the second half of the program, and let these questions be limited to the certificate program in early childhood care and education. And we would request the audience not to pose questions that are very general in nature, that are related to the policy matters of the university. So please confine your questions to the certificate program in early childhood care and education. First of all, let me explain the objectives with which this program has been started. The main objectives of the certificate program in early childhood care and education, it enables the teacher trainees to achieve the objectives of strengthening the professional competencies of preschool teachers, developing an understanding of the various methods and approaches of organizing learning experiences for pre-primary school children, understanding the nature of the learning process and developing skills required in selecting and organizing learning experiences. Developing skills involved in dealing with the academic and personal problems of children. Developing skills in selection, development, and usage of activities. And developing an understanding of the various techniques of management in the classroom situation. So, all these are related to early childhood education. And coming to the duration of the program, it is 1 year program, whereas the student can complete the program in a maximum period of 3 years. The medium of instruction is English. The eligibility to enter into this program is, first of all, the candidate should be 18 years old on 1st of July 2015, and then the candidate should have passed intermediate or 10 plus 2 examination. So, these are the two eligibility criteria. Coming to the admission, the candidate will be required to fill in the online application form, take a printout of it, attach the eligibility certificate, that is intermediate or plus 2 qualification, and submit it in the regional coordination center that is nearest to them. All over the state, we have the regional coordination centers, and they have to submit the application form in the regional coordination center, and they would receive an SMS message, and then they can make the payment of the fee. The program centers are the contact points. These are located in all the regional coordination centers that are established in the headquarters of the various districts. So, you may choose a program center that is nearest to you and that is convenient, where you can attend the academic counseling classes that are held regularly. So, all the regional coordination centers of Ambedkar Open University located in various district headquarters will be the program centers. Coming to the program fee, it is one time payment and the candidate has to pay 4,200 rupees as the course fee. So, candidates seeking admission to the program are required to pay the fee after submitting the filled in application form and receiving communication from the university. With regard to the program structure, the program is essentially a judicious mix of both theory and practical courses to develop knowledge, skills, and positive attitude among the teacher trainees, that is, the preschool teachers. Considering the job requirements of preschool teachers and broad program objectives, we have identified 4 courses. The course titles are Principles of Early Childhood Care and Education, Significance of Early Childhood Care and Education, Planning and Implementation of Early Childhood Care and Education Program, Administration and Management of Preschool and Daycare Centers. These are the 4 theory courses, and we have lot of practical component. In addition to the set theory courses, emphasis is laid on skill development. The practical work is based on the subject content presented in the various theory courses. The practical experiences are suitably categorized and organized under the school-based and workshop-based practicals and practice teaching. The instructional system would be, it includes the multimedia approach, that is, self-instructional print material is the dominant medium, and audio-visual components, counseling sessions, and practical work in the preschool and workshops are the other components. The print materials are self-instructional in nature. For both theory and practical components of the program. The material is supplied to the students by the university, and each course has number of blocks and each block has number of units. There would be around 12 units in each of these courses. The audiovisual programs are produced by the university and they are made available in the study centers, and at the same time the video lessons are broadcast over the Doordarshan regularly by the university. And also we have the teleconferencing, that is two-way audio and one-way video teleconferencing taking place periodically. Before we proceed further, I would like to pose a question to the expert, one of the experts, Dr. Vani, that is about the stage of early childhood and its significance. Yes, madam.
Okay. Actually, the first few years, that is 0 to 6 years, or some of them say from prenatal to 8 years of age, is considered as early childhood. Regarding the early childhood stage, the importance of early childhood, all psychologists and researchers have found that this is a very crucial stage, and these are very critical years and significant, because children are very curious. The growth and development are very, very rapid during this stage. So, these are very significant years. Whatever we do during these first few years of the childhood, they are very impressionable and they help us in making the child grow into a developed, responsible and great unique adult who contributes a lot to the society. Almost 50% of the intellectual development takes place during the first 5 to 6 years only, and most of the personal and social habits are also formed by the time the child is 4 years or 5 years old. So, it is like a now or never situation. Taking care of the child, attending to his needs, satisfying his needs, and then especially treating the child with respect, giving him a lot of confidence, helping him to develop his own self-concept, treating him, giving him lot of warmth, love and affection, security, and designing an environment which is stimulating and nourishing is very, very important. The parents can design a program, especially parents can know how they really could treat the children, and teachers can know how to handle the children, and everyone who comes across a child has to really understand the child, and hence this program, that is this certification course, is very, very important for each one of us who always come across a child or a number of children in our lives.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Mulanli, when will this early childhood education program really start?
Actually, in the academic setup, we have centers where they take care of the child from 2.5 years onwards, like nursery, they say, or preschool setup, they say. Some kind of differences are there. There are varied kinds of establishments are there, nursery schools, they say, play schools, they say. And also it starts, the very basic issue starts at the crèche level, that is, even before 2.5 years, the child needs some care. So, there are also crèches which take care of such kind of children at that particular age. So, when you look into the very starting or the beginning of the early childhood care part of it, the child, when it starts entering into the preschool setup around 2.5 years old, this is where the child will start entering into the social world or society. and try to interact with the adults. So this a larger setup where it will also meet its own peer group. So this is how it starts at 2.5 years, and it continues in some areas they are restricting to 6-year-old. Like if you see Montessorial system, they go up to 8-year-old in our setup, early primary we call. So like that, it ranges in different institutions. So broadly speaking, we can say from 2 years to that of 8 years, or 2 years to that of 6 years, we may consider it as the stage where child needs lot of protection and care, as madam has already discussed about the program details and significance of early childhood education.
I think mostly it is agreed upon that the range is 3 to 6.
Yeah.
Most
yeah.
of the
yeah.
time.
2.5 because to 6 or something you can
yeah.
say. Nursery they start at 2.5, and it some of the schools will take them at LKG they call, or
right. early lower kindergarten,
upper kindergarten.
Yeah.
So varied kinds of situations are there. So they say nursery, LKG, UKG. So different patterns are there in the corporate sector.
Yeah, actually 0 to 2 they two. Say it is infancy. Mm.
Yeah,
and then 3 to 6 they are called preschool years, and 6 to 8 as primary school, and mostly 3 to 6 preschools are very very important. Mm. Because that 6 to 8 years stage is overlapping with the primary area also. So I think the prenatal is also very important.
Mm.
Because even before the child is born, the mothers, nursing mothers, and you know, pregnant women, the care of the pregnant women and nursing women is also very important for the physical well-being and health of the individuals.
Even
so, like mostly we say
yeah,
0 to 8, but it varies and differs from school.
Even researchers
to school.
Have said, and many even medical doctors are also, you know, with their research they were sharing other day, that a parent whatever experiences in the, you know, the
during pregnancy,
yeah. it will have an impact on the child also. Maybe if the parent is with stress or some kind of problems, it will have an impact on the womb and further when the child takes birth.
Can so we say this is a critical period?
Yeah, very, very
in the development.
Yeah, it's very critical because one more thing I would like to share. Madam always keeps saying about the brain development part of it. These days it is the neuro, you know,
science
neurosciences are emerging, and lot of research is going on. So always we used to say by the time the child comes to 2 years old, about 80% of the brain development gets over, and by 5th or 6th year almost 90 to 95% of the brain development completes. So all the neurons that have to come into the developmental process will take place by 6 years. That means it's so critical and very precious time where we can't miss out. Madam,
yeah,
can
actually,
share about this.
Actually, even before, you know, we have this modern technological equipment and all that, our psychologists have emphasized the importance of the development, like
yeah.
The intellectual development, how it takes place and how rapidly it takes place and all that. But with the intervention of the sophisticated equipment and all that, we are really seeing
the smart
with the physically we are seeing how the size of the brain is increasing and how the shape of the brain and even the weight of the brain, how it is changing and all that. It's very interesting, and all the researches that have been made long back by the great psychologists like Piaget, you know, they are supported by the recent brain developmental studies also, and the modern gadgets are also giving us an experience.
We can see
witness them physically.
How it is really happening with children.
Yeah, that is very interesting, yeah. And thanks to science and technology.
If you just observe a child of 2, 2.5 year old, they are operating the smartphone, they are able to connect to any app and they are able to use it. It's really wonderful. Probably it is because of the exposure they have. The kind of experiences they have, the facilitation is being given by the parents at home and also in the school experiences.
I know they are. That is why you know these years are very very critical, because it's a foundation stage, because it prepares the adult for the entire
life
later life and all that. Now the total global focus is on this early childhood
education.
Because everyone is recognizing that an investment on early childhood education or investment on the child is, you know, an investment for human resource development as well as the economic development of the entire globe as such. Mm-hmm. Because the I have just seen like some 20% of the world's total children population is going to be in India mm-hmm. only. So all the more it is very important for us as educators and for all viewers who are going to take up this course to really concentrate on these children during this critical period mm-hmm. and contribute a lot for their proper growth and development.
Yeah, in fact, this is what goes on in our academic counseling sessions.
Yeah.
That is, the university would conduct academic counseling in the program centers, that is the regional coordination centers. So generally, the academic counseling sessions will be held at the program centers, and the academic counseling will include clarifications required in the print material and the audio-visual programs that are produced by the university. So, when a student attends the academic counseling sessions, he can seek clarification of his doubts, and then this is how he or she can enrich, and this is how they grow. Workshops are also conducted by the university for 16 days duration in 2 or 3 spells with intensive face-to-face interaction to develop skills and competencies will be organized by the program centers. The student teachers will have to do practical work and various activities required for the development of teaching skills and competencies in the preschool under the guidance of the supervisor and the headmistress. A student is expected to do internship for 24 days in the year. So, this is the practical component in addition to the theory courses that are provided by the university. This is pre-primary education is supposed to be child-centered. We say this is supposed to be child-centered. I request Dr. Vani to throw some light on this child-centered education.
Yeah, and this entire program is supposed to be, or rather it should be organized as a child-centered program. A child-centered program means, you know, the child is at the center, that is the curriculum, the learning experiences, materials and all the other activities are designed around the child on the basis of the needs of the child, to meet with the interests of the child, where you can really make the child very happy, explorative and make learning very joyful. Like, it is not something that the child should do what the teacher asks him to do, or it is not simply reading or reciting or mugging up what the teacher asks him to do. It is like, you know, on his own the child has to explore and select his own materials, engage himself in activities that he chooses to do and all that. So, lot of freedom is there on the part of the child, that is the environment should really give space for a sort of a freedom for the child to choose so many activities, experiences and all that. So, teachers should help children select, you know, the activities depending on their style of learning or interest or their cultural background and all that. What do you say, Dr. Milani?
Like if you just recollect our own childhood, there was nothing like, you know, organization or arrangement till 5 in the joint family system. The whole family, the whole environment used to be our learning centers. Whatever we like, we used to go, we used to pick up, we used to play. This is how interact with adults, learn some values and learn about the behavior. And they used to really just keep observing us. They never used to say, do this, don't do this. They used to just observe us and we used to take up whatever we used to do. So, this is how exactly a very home, at home feeling the child should feel, and they should feel free to do whatever they want to do. Like if you observe in some of the corporate schools, there are some periods allocated. This time it is the cleaning time, this time it is activity time, this time this some time. Now, when you really restrict a child to do what they intend to do, I feel it is not really called child-centered, though you may set up the whole lot talking in terms
especially
of
I feel that there is no, they shouldn't feel that somebody is always observing them or monitoring them or they are under the control of somebody. Like, you know, you should do this by this time, no sleep, like nappy parents, you know, even if the child doesn't get sleep, he is asked to enforce it to sleep. No, like, you know, lot
that,
of
that is not child centered. So, a child should feel, I can do what I want to do. I will do what I want to do. I am free. You know, this feeling the child should get, that kind of an environment is called, you know, child-centric kind of a system.
Yeah. Restrictions are minimal.
Minimal.
Yeah.
So that they can come up with
their own expression, feelings, whatever, emotional satisfaction, whatever you say, you know, the child should feel, this is my world. No, this is a feeling we should give. This is my world. I can do what I want to do.
So can we also say this early childhood education is preparation for the primary education?
Yeah, definitely it prepares the child for primary education, because basically this early childhood education program concentrates on the holistic development, like developing various social skills, proper habits, proper hygiene and health habits, toilet training, washing hands, and emotionally also trying to have a lot of control over one's own feelings, and giving, waiting for one's own turn, sharing and caring, and how best you can really work with others cooperatively. All such things, you know, like school is school, the name of the school will not frighten the child. He will not cry like I have to go to school and all that. So he gets used to this sort of an environment, and a smooth transition takes place from preschool to primary school.
So early childhood education is nothing
like, you know, they say in the preschool they also provide some space for the pre-academic aspects, like
pre-reading, pre-writing,
and pre-numbers.
And we have some
just
readiness,
readiness programs. You know, these things somehow there will be, as madam said rightly, it's a very smooth transition from the pre-primary to primary. Otherwise, a child suddenly, when even some of the things I would say, it's a kind of miseducation is happening in many of the schools. So definitely, many parents, you know, I have heard some parents speaking to each other that there is no homework. There is nothing is given for the child to do. They don't do anything. They just play in the school. So there are some misconceptions about the preschool in many parents. I believe this kind of course, even if they don't go and work in somewhere in a school or earn some money, if not that, at least they should do this course, at least to understand their own child, whether the teacher or wherever preschool centers they are going, are they properly providing them the required or necessary skills and the required environment and the facilities, or whatever they are giving, is it rightly going or not? Just to know that whether their child is growing properly or not also, I believe this kind of program would definitely help. Even a mother who is a homemaker also needs to know about this particular program. I feel very much, or I recommend to many parents who stay at home also can take up such kind of a course and understand it.
Yeah, very right. Because it is only the parents who are so, I mean,
eager,
ambitious.
Yeah.
Like the child, immediately when the child comes back home, they will ask, what did you learn? What did they tell in the school? Like, so
anxious.
They expect,
like,
some,
you know,
outcome
every day. Whether they are the ABCD, ABCD, did you learn ABCD?
Yeah.
Or, you know what, like they immediately see, turn the pages of the notebook and all that. So especially that the 3 hours in the preschool program should not make them read or write or do, make them do some number work and all that. It's all, the focus is on the holistic
preponing
development.
Primary, they are also calling preponing primary.
Yeah.
Many schools.
Primary education is rather thrust into this preschool.
Yeah.
So even schools are eagerly, I mean, trying to teach them, you know, maths.
Primary.
Primary, all half the primary syllabus they want to thrust into preschool level. That is very
Something very wrong. It will have.
As you have rightly observed, you said this is supposed to provide a holistic
development.
Yeah.
Can you throw light on that?
Yeah, it will take care. Physical, the social, madam has already shared how a child gets socialized in the environment, you know, interacting with the peer group and you know, learning together and cooperation, collaboration, and a project when they conduct or an activity when they do. When you give a group activity, both the children will start working together, understanding each other and developing some empathetic skills where they really wait for other or look for other and feel the pain of the other child or provide a space for another child to work along with. So like that, you know, a kind of socialization process goes, and emotional outburst also. Suppose if you give some play, they go for outdoor play, there is running, there is jumping, there are rhymes where the children are allowed to do lot of physical activity. So the emotional part of it, the aggression that is there in a child or whatever, the that kind of a speed that the child has, normally we observe children fight. When you give such kind of outdoor activities where energy is totally thrown out, you even find in some preschools there are sandbags where the child will hit the sandbag and lot of its energy is really shared out.
Outlet to their stress and emotions.
And they play a doll play. If you observe a doll play, the child will repeat, replicate the experiences from home. You can see whether the child has a positive kind of environment at home or a negative kind of environment, what kind of treatment the child gets. So these are all kind of outlets where the emotional development is also taken care of, and intellectual aspect of course with all the pre-academic and other activities they do take care. So like that, the holistic physical, social, emotional, intellectual, whatever dimension you say, there is a space in the preschool program.
To just conclude and summarize, you know, the development preschools or early childhood education contributes to holistic development, means like, you know, they take care of the social development, emotional development, intellectual development, and there are lots of opportunities to foster and nurture creativity, because we know children are very, very curious, enormously curious. One professor in physics was telling, you know, very casually we say, twinkle twinkle little star, how I wonder what you are. But you know what a curiosity, how you really wonder when you see the star in the sky. You know, that's sort of curiosity has to be ignited. It's there in the child innately, and that has to be ignited. And you know, and the flexibility is there. Like when they become adults, you know, they become non-flexible,
very rigid.
You know, you have rigid opinions and inhibitions and all that. But these children are plastic, and they are, you know, very flexible. So you know, flexibility and curiosity, they are very important for the creative development of the children. So creativity can be fostered, and you can really make the individuals as highly creative sculptors, painters, and you know,
whatever innate potentiality is,
you know, help the child to grow into his realizing his maximum potentialities as such.
I think would be fostering their physical growth, that is by involving them in various activities so that they can stretch their muscles.
That is gross.
That's how we contribute to the fine and gross motor development. And by involving them in these various activities, there would be cognitive development, at the same time socio and emotional development, all these things taking place. Madam, we say this early childhood education is supposed to adopt the play way method. What exactly do we mean by this, Dr. Vani?
Yeah, mostly this play is the central, in whether you say group dance or singing or reciting rhymes, you know, with action or dance, or you know, like sing, individual play is there, wherein you know they really sometimes, you know, in the playground or in the classroom, arranging the sequences or, you know, matching the shapes with the color or sizes. All this, you know, the activities and the experiences are centered around some play techniques only. Could you elaborate?
Actually, you know, many parents say, you first do your homework, then go for play. So this is where we always think that play is something different from learning. This is where parents don't understand. But if you observe a preschool child, the learning happens through play. It's very natural. A child loves to play, whether it is a indoor game or an outdoor game. These days, if you see, all children are indulging in computer games or with the mobile they keep playing. So they love play, whether it is electronic play or a natural play. I believe they better enjoy with the natural play. So this preschool will provide them both outdoor play activities as well as indoor play activities. A child really develops that kind of enjoyment. It enjoys the amusement it gets through lot of exploration of the, whether it is activities or play materials or games, some games, you know, all these children games.
In the playground they can be leaders.
Leaders.
They can formulate their own rules and norms.
They understand all these things.
Sometimes they can design their own different
games.
Plays.
They do that. They do that. They sometimes fight. They understand.
Yeah.
They even learn, as you said, they wait for their turn and understand how to.
And sometimes they innovate their own
play things. Also. Yeah.
They and alternate play things.
Yeah. They imitate. They imitate. Yeah. Mother, they imitate father,
so
characters
of their own, and even then they frame their own rules and regulations.
Role play they do. Yeah. They do. They imitate parents, they imitate many people around, and they show that is all a kind of a play where child will really enjoy and
you
learn
just
many
can't
things.
Separate
play from learning. These two go together. So that's why I said parents don't understand. They say, wait, you first do your homework, then go for play. This is where we need to connect both of them. Then children will really.
Just because they are interested, they would be more interested
in the play,
playful activities. So it is through the playway method that we would like to
teach. Make them
introduce.
To learn instead of teaching,
introduce,
I would say.
And then that is how we would like to take them into the mainstream. Yeah.
Right.
Of the
develop them properly,
process.
You know.
Yeah.
Give all kinds of development.
So
smoothly.
That they can enjoy.
Enjoy.
So that they can
learning
enjoy
can
their
be
learning
enjoyable
process.
Experience. Yeah. You know, right.
Madam, how is this early childhood education program going to promote healthy habits among children?
Yeah, because basically, you know, as part of personality development or physical development, main emphasis during early childhood program is on personal cleanliness and hygiene. And you know, like as I already repeated, this toilet training, washing hands, and then eating on their own, a sort of a mouth-hand coordination where the child learns to eat on his own. And you see, the health habits, hygiene, personal health and hygiene, especially washing hands, we just, you know, a very simple thing, Purakalam. We used to say, as soon as one comes, you know, you wash your hands and come home, come for dinner or something like that. But these days it is recognized that simply by washing hands or use that hand wash, so many diseases, you know, you can prevent or avoid it.
They even give advertisement on television, that Dettol wash, Lifebuoy wash.
It's very, very important. Yeah. And recently, you know, in the hospital, they complained that even doctors are not using they are not cleaning their hands properly and all that. So this sort of a training is very, very important, because some of these social and habits related to hygiene are formed by the time the child is 4 years old.
Yeah.
And however much we say after the child grows into an adult, somehow it doesn't register in them, and they continue their good or bad habits.
Okay, it's a kind of, you know, habit formation. When one starts at that formative stage, and just through activity, let us say I used to see in a preschool, they keep a bowl of water and make the child to wash and show them, see how the water has become dirty, see you are carrying all this into your mouth. And many children even use, even they are very young, so this oral kind of, you know, keeping everything in their mouth. So the safety part of it, this safety leads to even hygiene part, health part of it. They should not put in the mouth, because some of them are lead based colors. They should use a safety color. These all things, you know, go hand in hand, safety, security and health measures they go. So these things, maybe the preschool centers, if they take care and provide appropriate kind of things, and parents also know about these things and make it just a habit. No, it need not be just insisted on them. The self-help skills, as madam was rightly pointed out, how to eat. Children will not eat. Even parents don't like them to eat. They make them to eat. They feed them even maybe till their 8th standard, 9th standard. So if you just encourage this kind of self-help skills where they eat and develop this all sorts of eye-hand coordination or muscular coordination.
That's very right, especially that
so these things
habit
through
formation.
This habit formation, if we can really give, I think health becomes integral part of their personality.
Yeah. There is an incoming call, so let us take
please.
The phone call.
I pin.
Hello.
That's the best.
Yes, please.
Hello.
Yeah.
Can I put a question, sir?
Sure.
Yes. Yes, please.
Yeah, sir. A small question. The triangular solution I wanted. There was a saying: spare the rod and the spoil the child. There's one thing you know it very well.
Okay.
And on the other hand, child is the father of nation. There's another thing.
Okay.
And
not
one
father
Greek
of
says,
nation.
Natural consequences of the broken home are due to the lack of parental care. This is a triangular question.
Okay.
So my simple question is: what is the holistic solution? Which can give the progressive or the best results?
May I know who is calling?
My name is D. Kishore Kumar, an advocate.
Okay. Yeah.
My name is D. Kishore Kumar, speaking from Monastery Prem, sir.
Okay.
I'm an advocate in the high.
Okay.
Father of
man.
Yeah.
My
he's the future, sir. Father of man. There is a statement. Jesus, the father of man. Ma'am, he's saying nation. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Spare the rod, spoil the child. How do you react to this?
Spare the rod, spoil the child.
Dr. Vani.
Actually, you know, I think the best way is only through love and affection that we can cause a change and transform the lives of the children. You know, the first question to a teacher or a parent is always, do you love your child? Are you willing to really help him? And you know, the sort of security and safety and the sort of belongingness and the acceptance that he or she gets from the parent or the teacher, that is very, very important. And you know, the habits or the other values, they have to be, you know, inculcated during these years only. Like if these years are not taken care of, naturally they turn out to be aggressive adults. So like sir, your question is like is the seed or plant, like what is
actually
which comes first?
Actually, like, the question which he was posing, like, you know, in the olden times, in the name of discipline, they used to have a rod in the hand or a cane in the hand. The child used to be fearful about the teacher by looking at the cane, and this caning used to happen. That is corporal punishment. Today we have banned under RTE, no corporal punishment. Even emotionally also you have no right to really abuse the child or punish the child or emotionally disturb the child. So once you start respecting your child, listen to the child. You know, I would just suggest to all the parents, first you should listen to the child, respect the child. Once we listen to them, we always say whatever they are saying, we think we know it, and we snub them. So this is where probably parents should always remember. These days, even I feel in the newspapers we see every day, there are beatings happening even in the schools, at home. Whatever you give to the child in the childhood, that becomes their personality in future. I would just give one example, like sometimes without our consciousness we say, this fellow always makes noise, this fellow is very good. So from the beginning we keep telling these words to children, they become that. So they will become quiet in their personality, this fellow always makes noise. So it's a kind of reinforcement we keep and make that personality. So the kind of beatings, the child, if you beat them, they get used to this beating and they think, what else the parent will do, they will beat me, that's all. So this is something wrong, a kind of training or a thing we are giving in the childhood, if at all we give, that should be totally banned and totally taken care of, both the parents and teachers.
And not only that, you know, the very self-concept of the child is damaged.
Because
one psychologist says, like, you know, your self-concept is like always a price tag with you. Like whatever the parents say you are very noisy, you don't, read, or you are not very disciplined as your sister, or you are not very studious as your brother. If you keep comparing like that, you know, that is very wrong, and the concept of the child, the self-concept of the child gets damaged. And so if you are, he is not so intelligent, or he is not so hardworking as my elder daughter is, or my younger son is.
They should avoid.
These statements, you know, the parents should avoid, because that damages the self-concept.
So actually we should contribute to development of self-esteem.
Self-esteem.
So that they develop the self-confidence.
Right.
Because with self-confidence, we can conquer so many things. Let us take another phone call. Yes, please. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, please.
May I ask? Sir, we have been watching this program, sir.
Okay.
I hear that. Hello, sir.
Yes, please. Please introduce yourself.
I am Murthy calling from Guntur, sir.
Okay. Yes, please.
I have been trying to understand the kind of I feel that all the people have been sending their children to English medium schools nowadays.
That's right.
And from which class? Is it from nursery or LKG or UKG should we focus on language development, particularly English?
Okay. Yeah.
I would like the professors to throw some light on that.
Okay.
Because this IIT trend has gone down to KG level now.
Right.
They have cycles
KG
of exams and written tests, oral tests and all that.
Okay. Yeah.
How good and healthy are they, or what and how should we assess a child in the primary education?
Okay.
That's my question.
Okay. Dr. Mrinalini, would you like to answer
actually
this?
If you just look into the development, child language is a part of growing. It's one of the aspects of development. Language, without language you cannot communicate. The child will come with a home language or mother tongue as a language. So in a preschool we start with probably in many preschools they are starting with English language. Like even if we see our new development in the government also, KG to PG English medium kind of a proposal is there. So mostly the language is something which should facilitate the child and give them at home feeling. So as per Chomsky, one of the psychologists say, it's a grammarian rules, any number of languages the child can pick up, no problem, but the child should be able to comprehend what we speak. The child should feel comfortable. So probably let them use English, no problem, but at the same time let them ensure that the child is comfortable with that language. Don't totally go with one language. Instead, bilingual language you can use, even you can go for multilingual system where many children come with different languages. Let them speak, let them share. Probably all children will pick up many languages. English can also be a part of the language, but totally don't enforce on English language, and even don't expect that, or even if you can pursue with the administration of the school.
Yeah,
you can just add.
Yeah. There should not be any strict, instruction that the medium of instruction should be English only, and no child should be allowed to speak in other than English. That sort of an enforcement should not be there, because we always say in the planning of curriculum that the ECU curriculum should be culturally relevant and it should really represent the needs and interests of the society, and it should be community based. You know, it should emerge from the interests of the community and the culture of the community. So we feel like, you know, the folklore, the songs and the rhymes, the children should be free to really dance and sing and play the games and the songs and the other poems related to their culture. You know, you have so many songs related to that Mavanade, Mavasade,
yeah,
we
yeah.
have been to
some
districts of the Adilabad, some mandals of the Adilabad districts, where they are the Lambadas, they were enjoying singing and dancing, very joyfully they have been learning and enjoying. At the same time, they were not backward in English. They were speaking English also fluently, and always the psychologists say that there is enormous capacity for the child for language development during these early years. I have seen lots of children, you know, with Telugu as mother tongue, if they are grown in a foreign country or other state, you know, how many years of teaching can never result in such sort of a fluency in the other languages. How many? See, 10 years I learnt Hindi during my schooling, but I cannot speak Hindi so fluently as the child who grew in Uttar Pradesh during his childhood. That is, you know, object to the introduction of English or any other language, because we should be tolerant, because the child has enormous capacity during these years for language development, and they can learn easily so many languages, and there is wonderful opportunity for them to learn.
I would just share, madam, the environment. The environment, like, you know, many children are picking up Hindi by watching some cartoons in Hindi.
Right.
And they are picking up English through cartoons. Some personality traits they are imitating, like Bandura studies, a lot of research resulted how the child will imitate. So, and through imitation,
the language,
they have banned Chota Bheem in some of the places.
Yeah.
So, the language, they just by observation, by imitation, so they will pick up any number of languages because they have the potential to grasp and then get it, like, you know, as
I
we
think
were thinking.
Yeah. This is the best period, best period for language development.
That's
because
why
I remember
stimulant environment.
Fourth year is the best period for
language development.
So they can pick any number of languages.
Yeah. No
say
problem.
In addition to the mother tongue that they speak at home, once they go to the school, they may be interacting with their classmates in Telugu, Hindi, and any number of languages. I think that is how most of us, that is most of Indians, are polyglots.
Yeah.
That is how we develop to be, right?
Yeah.
At least three languages,
all of us can speak.
And this is the best period for language development. And I think we develop more, we stress more on the physical
development,
the cognitive
and
development, and those aspects. But they also develop the language part. And we are not supposed to insist on reading and writing, but we develop those pre-reading, those
pre-numbering
skills.
Pre-numbering
skills and
speaking,
those things.
Listening, all this will make them to learn languages.
Yeah. So, as far as language is concerned, I think more than the language, it is the development, the holistic development that we stress upon.
Yeah.
And it really should not make a difference, because it is the playway method that is supposed to be followed in the early childhood
it's
education.
Activity-based games, language games
and all stimulation.
Yeah.
That's all. It's stimulation if it is
providing
given.
That stimulating environment is
they
what
pick
is
up
more
on the
important.
Language.
So madam, just to continue our discussion, how this early childhood education is going to develop discipline among children?
Actually, today we are talking not disciplining, you know, the definition of discipline. What is discipline actually? You know, many people have different notions about discipline. Means sitting quiet, discipline means learning what I say, do what I say. I don't know, the definitions are different. So, discipline is positive, it should be positive, it should help them to grow positively, to become good, good also, an appropriate behavior, socially acceptable, or maybe what the child likes to be, the way it likes to be, maybe freedom, with all freedom, whatever the child likes, it should go in a proper way. Maybe there should be a caution, as many people, educationists, Niels and others, radicalists, they said, there should be caution. Suppose if the child is going out of the way, there is our necessity to interfere, maybe tell them about little bit, understand the consequences of it, or stop them from doing. Suppose the child is holding a razor, you know, we should stop them. You know, this is not the object the child has to play with. Such kind of things we can do. Discipline is something where we need to define what is real discipline, you know, a kind of positive development for which the discipline, the way you deal with, probably I would call it as a discipline. What, ma'am? You can also add something.
Would you like to add to that?
Yeah, like sometimes, you know, the children are very disciplined, a class is very disciplined, we say. I really do not consider a silent class as a disciplined class. Because children by their nature are very enthusiastic. They should always be playing and talking to each other. You know, we always these days say you have to be proactive. Like, you know, it's silence, communication in silence also. But if you say that you have to talk minimum, means not that you shouldn't talk, like you have to really initiate something. And that is, you know, sir, basically, because during the ECE program, we are concentrating on the holistic development. The child is going to be a developed individual, because he is very socially very sound, picking up social skills, sound emotional characteristics, and you know, create a lot of opportunity and possibilities for creative and intellectual development, and physical well-being is also taken care of. He is respected, loved, secure, no fear of anything, enjoying total safety,
freedom without fear, maybe freedom, discipline.
Yeah,
we can
so
say.
Like naturally, because all these things are there, ultimately, without telling, that the discipline becomes an integral part of the child, and that is how you see education.
A kind of self-discipline
we
can develop.
We should teach more of
self-discipline through freedom, freedom and responsibility.
That's right.
They should feel responsible, then they become self-disciplined.
Yeah, very thin line between freedom and discipline.
Yeah,
they should be able to enjoy freedom and discipline.
I think we should encourage interaction among the children. That is what we call socialization process, and also how they should interact with adults.
Yeah,
I think
manners
even
and
this
behavior,
is this is also important in the
mannerisms and
program.
Behavior.
In the overview, let me tell something about the evaluation process that is in the certificate program. For theory courses, evaluation comprises three aspects. That is, self-evaluation exercises are provided within the text, that is in-text questions that the students can answer, and then there will be term and examination, and for each course that is 50 marks. And then for the practical courses, evaluation comprises three aspects, that is continuous evaluation of school-based activities and practice teaching, that is when they go for internship, evaluation of performance in practical workshops when they are conducted, and then evaluation of practice teaching, actual teaching when they go for. So, and then there would be practical examination that has 50 marks. So, these the four courses, theory courses that we have included in this course are related to how to establish a early childhood education center, and how to organize the various activities, how to develop the material, and then what is the philosophy behind having early childhood education program, what is the importance of having early childhood education program, and this is how we would like to prepare teachers for the pre-primary sector. We would like to train people properly so that they can be effective pre-primary school teachers. So, I would like to thank the resource persons, Dr. Vani and Dr. Murali, for enriching us with their knowledge, and thank you very much.